Tonight we're going to continue our study in the Gospel of Mark, and we're going to focus on Mark chapter 11, verses 27 through 33. I'm also going to introduce that parable that's in Mark chapter 12, verses 1 through 12. Tonight I just want to introduce you to that parable. We don't have time to go over all the details, but next week we'll go through that parable verse by verse. We're in the final section of the Gospel of Mark, and the final section is actually a rather lengthy section. It's from chapters 11 all the way to the end to chapter 16. But really, those five chapters or six chapters only cover 8 days in the life of Jesus. It begins with Palm Sunday. It ends with Easter Sunday. There are three sections that, as we break this down. We're in this section called Confrontation. Jesus goes to Jerusalem for the very first time in the Gospel of Mark, and he's immediately confronted with some things. And part of it is Jesus does some things that are rather unusual. And people look at him and wonder, why did you just do that? And we're going to look at some of that tonight. Chapter 13 is Jesus' monologue on last things, coming events, what to expect in the days ahead. And then finally, chapters 14 through 16 is the story of the crucifixion and the resurrection. We're in this section called the Confrontation in Jerusalem. And it will take us from chapter 11, verse 1, through chapter 12, verse 44. It's the coming to Jerusalem. Jesus rides on a donkey in fulfillment of the prophecy in Zechariah that Jesus rides that donkey from Bethany to the gates of Jerusalem. The crowd is shouting things that would identify Jesus as Messiah and the coming of David's kingdom. So Jesus is proclaimed as Messiah. The only problem is only a few people hear it. The people in Jerusalem don't experience it. Most of the people shouting were people who had traveled with Jesus from Galilee to Jerusalem. And then at the end of that day, Jesus enters Jerusalem for the first time. He goes to the temple area. He looks around. Then he turns around and leaves and ends up in Bethany for that evening. And then the next day is the cursing of the fig tree and the cleansing of the temple. Jesus, that next day, Monday morning, will make his way from Bethany to Jerusalem. He sees a fig tree that has leaves, which means it should have the early fruit, but it doesn't. And so Jesus basically says to the fig tree, "May no one ever eat fruit from you again." And he places that curse on the tree. But it's not that Jesus doesn't like trees. The tree represents the nation of Israel. This is a prophetic, symbolic action that Jesus is doing. And we're going to find out why Jesus does that as we continue our journey through this section. And then Jesus goes to the temple area, and he begins throwing out the commercialism that is now part of the temple courts. He throws out the merchants. He overturns the table of the money changers, and he makes a scene. But apparently it's not a big enough of a scene that he gets arrested, but he does draw people's attention by what he does. That's where we left off. We begin tonight with the controversies. Chapter 11, verse 27, all the way through chapter 12, verse 44. So that's what we're going to begin this evening. There are seven controversy stories that Mark lists one right after another. So seven straight stories of controversy, which are very similar to what Mark did in chapter 2, verse 1 through chapter 3, verse 6. Back in those chapters, there were five controversy stories. The difference is, it's Passover week. It's Holy Week. Tensions are high. Jesus is now in Jerusalem. So these controversies take on a lot more energy. There's also a lot of give and take back and forth between Jesus and the religious leaders. And what we find in these controversies is that all of the influential elements of Jewish society will reject Jesus. It's not just there's this small faction of Judaism that's rejecting him. No, it's all of Judaism that's rejecting Jesus. And that's going to be pointed out in each of these controversy stories. But then there's the crowd. And it was amazing when Jesus was with the crowd in Galilee. They loved him. I mean, it was incredible. They would spend all day just listening to Jesus teach. And Jesus is having that same impact upon the crowds in Jerusalem. And in many ways, it's the crowds that keep the religious leaders from arresting Jesus right away. It also sets up the betrayal, because the religious leaders just can't go grab Jesus in the temple courts and arrest him. That would make a scene. The people would get upset. They may riot. The Romans are watching. It's Passover week. There's 300,000 people in Jerusalem. They don't want a riot. So they need to find a way to arrest Jesus secretly, quietly, with only a few people knowing about it. And that will set the stage for what Judas Iscariot will do on Thursday evening. So again, the crowds love him, but the religious leaders don't. They want to get rid of Jesus. These controversies take place in the temple area, in the outer courts, where many people have gathered day after day this entire week, getting prepared for the Passover. The day before, Jesus had cleared the merchants out of the temple courts. But it's the next day. The merchants have returned. So what Jesus does on Monday has no lasting impact because the merchants return on Tuesday to carry on their business. So what Jesus did on Monday wasn't to reform the temple. In many ways, it was to abolish the temple. It was a prophetic, symbolic action. Well, what does Jesus have against the temple? I mean, after all, the Jewish people, that was their pride and joy. I mean, they loved their temple. Herod, whom they didn't like, had beautified that temple for them. It was as beautiful as Solomon's temple. They loved that structure. But the temple was all about sacrifice for sin. Jesus was about to begin a new covenant. A new covenant that had no use for a temple, because Jesus would become the ultimate sacrifice for sin. Temple sacrifices would be replaced with Jesus, once and for all sacrifice. And as the Apostle Paul tells us, God doesn't live in a temple. God lives in the hearts and lives of those who believe in Jesus. So the temple gets replaced by believers in Jesus, people who put their faith in him. So it's also interesting that these seven controversies, they may have taken place in one day. It could have just been one controversy after another. That's a possibility. Or it could be that these controversies take place throughout the week, and Mark simply groups them together. And as we've seen, Mark has a tendency to group similar things together. But these were controversies that take place during Holy Week. And throughout these controversies, there's no time reference. Mark doesn't tell us what day it is. In fact, the next time reference will be in chapter 14, verse 1. But the climax of these controversy stories is when Jesus leaves the temple in chapter 13, verse 1, and Jesus in the Gospel of Mark will never again return to the temple. He will leave it once and for all. And again, that was symbolic, because the temple has no place in the new covenant. Well, let's begin these seven controversy stories, and it begins with a question of authority. Who has authority? Who has the most authority? Is it Jesus or the religious leaders? Now, obviously, the religious leaders get their authority from the people. It's their responsibility to look after the temple and everything that happens within the temple. The Jewish people have a supreme court called the Sanhedrin, and that governs all of political and religious life of the Jewish people. There is established authority within Judaism. But where does Jesus get his authority? I mean, what gave Jesus the right to go into the temple and start turning over tables? Who told Jesus he could do that? Where does Jesus get his authority? Well, it was those actions on the part of Jesus. Jesus turns over the tables. He makes a scene. Jesus shows up every day in the temple courts, and he's teaching people. Well, who said that Jesus could teach in the temple courts? Who gave Jesus authority to do that? And Jesus rides from Bethany to Jerusalem on a donkey, fulfilling an Old Testament prophecy about the Messiah. Who gave Jesus the authority to do that? Where does Jesus get his authority? That will become a big issue. Now, in this story, if Jesus wanted to, he could express his authority. After all, he is the Messiah, and he is the Son of God. But does Jesus want to say that on Tuesday of Passion Week? That becomes the issue. And what would happen to Jesus if he told the religious leaders, authority? I'm the Messiah. I have authority over the temple. And what if he told them that he was the Son of God? How would they respond? Well, let's look at the story. You'll find it in Mark chapter 11, verses 27 through 33. I want to read that story, and then we'll come back and talk about each of those verses. So, Mark chapter 11, beginning with verse 27. It says, they arrived again in Jerusalem. And while Jesus was walking in the temple courts, the chief priests, the teachers of the law, and the elders came to him. By what authority are you doing these things? They asked. And who gave you authority to do this? Jesus replied, I will ask you one question. Answer me, and I will tell you by what authority I am doing these things. John's baptism, was it from heaven or of human origin? Tell me. They discussed it among themselves and said, if we say from heaven, he will ask, then why didn't you believe him? But if we say of human origin, they feared the people, for everyone held that John really was a prophet. So they answered Jesus, we don't know. And Jesus said, neither will I tell you by what authority I am doing these things. So this first controversy, in many respects, ends in a draw. It ends in a stalemate between Jesus and the religious leaders. Well, let's look at it. It says they arrived again in Jerusalem. It is now Tuesday morning. And again on Sunday, that's when Jesus rode the donkey to the gates of Jerusalem. He goes into Jerusalem, he looks at the temple, and then he leaves. And Sunday ends. On Monday morning, that's when Jesus curses the fig tree. And then Jesus arrives in Jerusalem, and that's when he cleanses the temple. That's when he throws out the merchants and makes a scene in the temple courts. They go home again to Bethany, apparently staying with Lazarus, Mary, and Martha. Well, Tuesday morning, they again make the journey from Bethany to Jerusalem, about an hour's walk. And this time, the disciples notice that the fig tree has died. It has withered. They've never seen a fig tree die in 24 hours. Normally, it would take a very long time for that fig tree to die, but Jesus places a curse on it on Monday. The thing is dead by Tuesday. Then they walk into the temple once again. So this is Jesus' third journey into Jerusalem. And Jesus shows up in the temple courts, the same place that he had cleared out the day before. And once again, well, the merchants are back, the money changers are back. It was just as it was before Jesus threw everybody out. But Jesus is able to walk into those temple courts. So apparently what Jesus did on Monday was not something that was going to get him arrested, at least not arrested right away. It was more symbolic. It was more prophetic. Some people saw it, but people kind of ignored it, and they went on. However, it was enough that the leaders want to at least question Jesus about what he did. They can't just ignore what Jesus did. They're not ready to arrest him, but they are ready to question him about what he did and why he did it. And it's interesting that when they question Jesus, it's not just looking for information. There's some hostility behind their question. You know, who gave you the right to come into our temple and do what you did? You know, that's our responsibility to have authority over the temple, not your responsibility. You don't have the authority to do what you did. So when Jesus goes into the temple courts, again, he gathers some questioning, but they're not ready to arrest him. But Jesus does encounter the leading religious authorities in Jerusalem. So when you go to Jerusalem, you get to meet the big shots. And the big shots have now come out to question Jesus. And they are identified as the chief priests, the teachers of the law, and the elders. Those are the three groups that make up the Sanhedrin. The Sanhedrin was the Jewish Supreme Court. There are 70 members on the Sanhedrin. That's their Supreme Court. The one who presides over the Supreme Court is the high priest. The high priest is both the religious and the political leader in Israel. So this group, some of them, not all 70 of them, but some of them go out to question Jesus. There's the chief priests. These are the ruling priestly families in Jerusalem. And they've already made some deals with the Romans. They're quite wealthy. They have a great interest in the temple area. That's their pride and joy. They want to make sure that there are no riots. They want nothing to happen that will upset the Romans. Because if the Romans get upset, then they may lose their lives, they may lose their income, they may lose some of the freedom that they enjoy. So they control the temple area. So they have a vested interest in making sure that everybody keeps the peace in the temple area. We then have the elders. These are leading people, leading citizens, aristocrats in the nation of Israel, but they're not from the priestly families. These are very influential people, probably very wealthy people, and because of their influence, they've made their way to be part of the Sanhedrin, the Jewish Supreme Court. There's also the teachers of the law, the scribes, the Pharisees. These are the experts in Jewish law. And we've already met them in the Gospel of Mark. In chapter 3, they come to the conclusion that Jesus performs miracles in the power of Satan. That was their conclusion about Jesus in Mark chapter 3. In Mark chapter 7, they criticize Jesus because Jesus is not following their oral tradition. Yes, we have the Ten Commandments. Yes, we have the 613 Jewish laws. But they expanded on those laws. Those laws would eventually be written down in the second century. They're recorded in the Mishnah. But in the first century, they were passed on by word of mouth. They're the oral tradition. And these scribes believed that their laws were on par with God's laws. And so basically, their laws were just an expansion of God's laws, and their laws ought to be followed as much as God's laws are being followed. But Jesus wasn't playing their game. Jesus was more than willing to follow God's laws, but the oral tradition, Jesus paid no attention to. It did not have the same authority. So there's already been some tension between Jesus and the teachers of the law. Three times Jesus will make a prediction that he's going to be betrayed, handed over to the Gentiles, eventually executed, and then rise again. And it's interesting that in chapter 8, verse 31, and chapter 10, verse 33, Jesus will mention the chief priests, the scribes, and also the elders as those who will betray him and hand him over to the Gentiles. So Jesus already knows these are not his friends. This group of people has their own vested interest, and they are not interested in what Jesus is trying to do. They will not believe in Jesus. In fact, they will reject him, and eventually they will hand him over to be crucified. Well, Jesus meets up with this group of people, a very powerful group of people, and they have a couple of questions for Jesus. And in many respects, these questions are legitimate questions. They want to know from Jesus, by what authority are you doing these things? These things would be clearing out the temple. These things would be teaching in the temple courts. And maybe these things would also include riding the donkey into the gates of Jerusalem. Who gave you the authority to do those things? They want to know the answer to that question. In whose name or by whose power are you authorized to do this? Did somebody give you permission to do these things? Then they ask a second question, and who gave you authority to do this? In other words, we did not give you authority to do those things. So who did? You know, are you claiming to be a prophet? Are you claiming that God gave you authority to do these things? Or did you get authority from someone that we don't know about? These leaders would say, we have the responsibility. We have authority over the temple area. And you have come in here without our authority, and you're acting as if you have authority. So who gave you that authority? That's what they want to know from Jesus. What is the source of your authority? Now, if you were a teacher of the law, you would quote another rabbi, and that other rabbi would be your source of authority. There are 70 members on the Sanhedrin. Did any of the 70 give Jesus permission to do these things? And obviously the answer is no. Jesus has no human authority to do anything in the temple area. We know that Jesus' authority is divine, but from a human perspective, Jesus did not have any authority to do what he did. So why ask these questions? The Sanhedrin wants Jesus to confess. Because if Jesus confesses, he's guilty of a crime. He's guilty of going into the temple area and doing things that he has no authority to do. Jesus is speaking things and doing things that nobody gave him permission to do. Jesus has no authority, and Jesus ought to confess that he did something wrong. These questions are questions that Jesus really doesn't want to answer. Because Jesus has to tell the truth. And if Jesus answers these questions truthfully, he's going to have to say that God gave him authority to do those things. And God gave him authority because he is the Messiah. And as Messiah, he has authority over the temple. Jesus would also have to confess that he's the Son of God. And as the Son of God, he has authority over the temple. But Jesus doesn't want to do that right now. If Jesus were to confess everything at this point, he would have probably been immediately arrested. And the crucifixion would probably have not happened on Friday. It may have happened on Wednesday. And everything that happened on Wednesday and Thursday would not have happened. So Jesus knows this is not the time to answer that question. So what do you do if somebody asks you a question and you don't want to answer it? Especially if you know you can't lie in your answer. Well, Jesus does what the rabbis would often do. He's going to ask a counter question. And back in the first century, when people debated, it was common to ask a counter question, either to clarify an issue or to find out where the other person is coming from and asking their question. So Jesus basically says to the religious leaders, okay, I'll answer your question if you can answer my question. And what is so unusual about what Jesus did is that Jesus made his answer dependent upon their answer. So Jesus says, if you answer me, then I'll answer you. If you don't answer me, then I'm not going to answer you. So it's a counter question. And it's interesting that the religious leaders didn't accuse Jesus of foul play. It was perfectly fine to ask a counter question. It was perfectly fine to argue in this way. So the religious leaders play along. So the religious leaders ask Jesus a question he doesn't want to answer. And in response, Jesus is going to ask the religious leaders a question that they don't want to answer. Jesus was great at debate. Jesus was quick-witted in what he was able to do. Because here's Jesus' question. John's baptism, was it from heaven? Or was it of human origin? And when he talks about John's baptism, he's talking about the entire ministry of John the Baptist. John the Baptist came proclaiming that God's kingdom was coming, the Messiah was coming. So you need to repent of your sins, you need to be baptized, and get your heart ready for the coming of the Messiah. In fact, Mark's gospel begins with the ministry of John the Baptist. John the Baptist prepared the way for the coming of Jesus. And John the Baptist's ministry was one of repentance and the forgiveness of sins. So, in many ways, Jesus is going to link his ministry with the ministry of John the Baptist. And when Jesus begins preaching, what's Jesus' message? Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is near. Jesus preached the same message of repentance that John the Baptist preached. So in many ways, Jesus is answering their question without answering their question. Jesus is saying, my authority comes from the same place where John the Baptist got his authority. Our message is the same. Our source of authority is the same. So, what is our source of authority? I'll give you two choices, and you must choose one. Is it from heaven, from God, or is it of human origin? Was John simply acting out of his own accord? So in other words, If it's heaven, if it's God, then God sent John the Baptist. And God authorized the ministry of John the Baptist. If it's simply of human origin, then God didn't send John the Baptist. And John the Baptist was simply doing his own thing. In fact, we're about to find out that the religious leaders do not believe that the ministry of John the Baptist is from God. And they may even argue that John's ministry got cut short because John's ministry was not from God. So the religious leaders did not recognize John as a prophet. However, the people did. There's a great reference in Mark chapter 1, verse 5, that the people from Jerusalem went all the way to Jordan, where John the Baptist was, to hear him preach, to confess their sins, and to be baptized. So, as Jesus and the religious leaders are having this little debate among themselves, there's all of these people crowded around, listening. And there's 300,000 people. You know, you can't, it's difficult to find a private spot. So all these people are listening and they're hearing this question and they're answering that question for themselves. The ministry of John the Baptist, was it from God or did John just do his own thing? And they would say the ministry of John the Baptist is absolutely from God. There's a great verse in John chapter 1, verse 6. It says, there was a man sent from God whose name was John. The Apostle John recognizes that the ministry of John the Baptist, he was sent from God. But the religious leaders did not believe that. They just thought John was doing his own thing. So, interesting question. How do you answer it if you're a religious leader? In fact, in many respects, Jesus puts them in a very awkward position. Now, they've already put Jesus in an awkward position. He doesn't want to tell them where he gets his authority. And they don't really want to answer this question. So they discuss it among themselves. They discuss it not because they're unsure of their answer. They know their answer. They discuss it because, do we really want to say our answer out loud so other people can hear us? Do we really want to say in front of all of these people what we really believe about John the Baptist? And they really don't want to do that. So they discuss it among themselves as to what they should do. And their reasoning is, if we say that the ministry of John the Baptist was from heaven, then Jesus is going to ask us, why didn't you believe him? If John was really a prophet and you believe that, then why didn't you go down to the Jordan River, confess your sins, and be baptized by John? The religious leaders didn't. The religious leaders had their own establishment. And in many ways, John the Baptist was a threat to their establishment. They weren't about to confess their sins and be baptized by John. But if we say that John was just acting out of his own accord, he was doing his own thing, he wasn't sent by God, he was just, you know, one of these fly-by-night prophets who came and went. If we say that, they feared the people. For everyone held that John was really a prophet. So Jesus has them in this difficult situation. They don't want to answer the question. So what do? They answer Jesus by saying, we don't know. We can't figure it out. We don't know if the ministry of John the Baptist was from God or not from God. We don't know. Which I'm sure by saying that, they lost face with the people, but they would lose even more if they would say that the ministry of John the Baptist was not from God. So they're just going to say, we don't know. And Jesus says, neither will I tell you by what authority I am doing these things. Jesus refuses to answer their question as well. So in many ways, it ends in a stalemate. Jesus is asked a question he doesn't want to answer, and Jesus responds by asking his opponents a question they don't want to answer. And so at the end of the day, neither party answers the question. But in some respects, Jesus answered the question in an indirect kind of way. Jesus' authority comes from the same source as John the Baptist's authority. And God authorized John the Baptist to proclaim this message of repentance and forgiveness of sins. And in the same way, God gives Jesus authority to do what he does and to say what he says. So in an indirect way, Jesus is saying, my authority for doing what I do comes from God. But the religious leaders, they would never believe that John was a prophet. And they're not going to believe that Jesus is a prophet either. And they are most certainly not going to believe that Jesus is the Messiah. They're going to say no. However, Jesus is the Messiah. And Jesus has already exercised his authority. They just don't understand what he did. You see, the day before, Jesus went into the temple and he overturned the tables and he threw out the merchants, which symbolically Jesus abolished the temple. Jesus predicted the destruction of the temple. The temple would be destroyed. As the Messiah, Jesus is eliminating the temple. Jesus has the authority to do that. And Jesus' prediction about the temple would be fulfilled 40 years later when the temple gets destroyed. Interesting debate, and the underlying message is that Jesus has authority from God. Well, we turn now, and I just want to introduce this tonight, to a parable of the wicked tenant farmers. Now, everything that's happened so far in chapter 11 has been rather interesting. Jesus cursing a fig tree. I mean, how many people really knew that Jesus was predicting the end of the nation of Israel? He was. The disciples really didn't understand that. By the time Mark records it, maybe people understand it. Reading about it 2,000 years later, yes, we get it. We understand what Jesus was doing. But at the moment, I don't think anybody really knew what Jesus was saying and what Jesus was doing. And by throwing tables out of the temple, clearing out the merchants, did anybody really guess that Jesus wanted to abolish the temple? Well, certainly not. We're going to find out in chapter 13 that the disciples look at Jesus and say, Jesus, that temple, it's really incredible. And then Jesus is going to say some interesting things about the temple in response. But this parable kind of brings it all together. This particular parable is a little different from the normal controversy story. The normal controversy story is that somebody comes up to Jesus, a religious leader, and they'll ask Jesus a question. Like the previous controversy story, you know, the Sanhedrin members come up to Jesus and say, you know, who gives you the authority to do what you do? But in this particular controversy story, nobody is going to ask Jesus a question. It's not going to be a dialogue like the previous story. This is going to be a monologue, and it's a monologue initiated by Jesus. Now, there's no change of location and no change of audience in chapter 12, verse 1. So Jesus is addressing this particular parable to the same group of people that just asked him about his authority. Jesus will address this to the chief priests, teachers of the law, and the elders. So the stories fit together. The first part of the story is that dialogue about authority. The second part of the story is Jesus' monologue about a parable that's directed against the religious leaders. The story ends in chapter 12, verse 12, with the religious leaders scratching their head, thinking, "We have no idea what Jesus just said. However, there's one thing we know for sure. We were the bad guys in Jesus' story. Jesus spoke that parable against us." That's what their conclusion was. And they're right about their conclusion, even though they didn't completely understand all that Jesus was trying to communicate. So this continues that discussion with the religious leaders. And Jesus is going to tell this parable. Let me explain it briefly this way. There's a certain man who owns a vineyard. He's the owner, but he doesn't want to work the vineyard. In fact, he doesn't even want to live in that particular city. He wants to leave and go live somewhere else. So he decides to basically turn over the vineyard to some tenant farmers. And these farmers would come and they would work the vineyard. They don't own the vineyard, but they work the vineyard. And every harvest season, they have to give some of that harvest to the owner as a payment for him allowing them to work his vineyard. It would be kind of like living in an apartment. If you live in an apartment, you don't own it. Somebody else does. But you get to live there. And every month, you have to pay for the right to live there. So that's kind of what's going on. These tenant farmers, every harvest season, have to give some of the proceeds back to the owner for the right to work his vineyard. So it's harvest season. The owner sends some servants to collect the harvest, part of the harvest. But the tenant farmers, instead of paying up, beat up the servant and send him away. It would be like if you were living in an apartment and it's rent time, and instead of paying your rent, you don't, and then the owner sends somebody to your door to collect the rent, and instead of paying the rent, you beat the guy up and send him on his way. Well, as it turns out, the owner sends some more servants to collect the harvest. Well, those servants either get beat up or some of them die. Finally, the owner decides to send his son, thinking that certainly they'll respect my son and pay up. But the tenant farmers think, you know, if we kill the son, maybe we can take over the land and make it our own. So they kill the son and throw him out of the vineyard. Then the owner finally gets justice. He presses charges against the tenant farmers. All of them are put to death because of what they've done. And then the owner gives that vineyard to new tenant farmers. That's the story Jesus tells. That's the physical story. There's a spiritual story behind this whole thing. The owner of the vineyard is God in the spiritual side of the story. The vineyard represents the nation of Israel. And we're going to find out from Isaiah chapter 5 that Jesus' parable is very similar to what Isaiah writes in chapter 5, where God is the owner and the vineyard represents Israel. The owner's servants that he sends to collect the harvest are the prophets. You see, God and Israel made a covenant, an agreement, that Israel would keep God's laws. But Israel was not keeping God's law, so God sent prophets to remind them that they weren't paying up. They weren't keeping their end of the bargain. So what happened to the prophets? Well, some they beat up, some they threw in jail, and some they killed. Israel has a huge reputation for not listening to the prophets. So then the owner, God, decides to send Jesus, his son, the Messiah. And what do they do with him? They kill him too. So Jesus knows all along what's going to happen to him. The farmers, who are they? Israel's leadership. Oh yes, the chief priests, the elders, and the teachers of the law. They did get it right. Jesus did speak the parable against them, and they are the bad guys in Jesus' story. The last part, there will be judgment. And the judgment comes in AD 70. Because Israel will lose its status as a nation. The Romans will destroy Israel, and Israel will cease to be a nation from AD 70 until 1948. It's the fig tree that got cursed. The temple, oh, it gets destroyed. That pride and joy gets set on fire, and most of it burns to the ground. The chief priests, well, they're out of a job. The high priest, he doesn't have a job anymore either. The elders are out of their land, and, well, the teachers of the law have to now turn to the synagogue to keep Judaism alive. Yes, that was the cleansing of the temple. So all of this comes together in that parable. And next week we're going to look at it in detail. So if you want to read it in advance, you now have an idea of what's going on. There's the physical story, and then there's the spiritual story. And everybody understands the physical story. Nobody really understands the spiritual story, but the religious leaders understand he meant that story against us. That was not a good story about us. Well, let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you for this incredible story of Jesus and the religious leaders. The authority that Jesus has. And Father, I pray that He has authority in our lives to lead us, to guide us. And Father, I thank you for this story of the parable and how it all comes together. And Jesus knew exactly what was going to take place. So Father, I just pray that through these stories we understand that we can trust Jesus, that we can trust His leadership, that He knows what's going on in our lives too. And He knows what's best for us. So, Father, we thank you again for teaching us, and we pray that you'll draw us closer to you as we seek to follow you day by day. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen.